economy democratically?
A different economy is possible.
This is the
economy for the common good.
Demonstration in the heart of San Francisco. People are protesting against the power of corporations, against Wall Street, and against the interdependency of corporations and the military. These are the months of the Occupy movement, where activists around the world are taking to the streets to regain sovereignty over their lives. The US police is advancing, martially equipped in riot gear, armored like ice hockey players with batons, firearms, fold-down visors.
Something unexpected happens. The protesters do not move back. Rather, they roll out small carpets, settle down, some in lotus position, close their eyes, concentrate on their breath, and go into meditation. Irritation and hesitation on the part of the state power. Calls for clearing the square. No one of the meditators reacts. At most, an enraptured smile. Then the laborious evacuation. The highly armed police carry the meditating activists away, like Buddha statues, smiling in lotus position. State power versus inner force. The question remains open. Which force is the stronger?
Which force is stronger, the inner or the state power? What resistance or civil disobedience means in our time, and what it can look like, this is the question we,
Andrea Behm,
and Reinald Schwarz want to pursue in today's English radio program of The Economy for the Common Good.
In addition to the topics of resistance and civil disobedience, we will deal with the World Economic Forum 2019 in Davos, Switzerland, and speak with Christian Felber, the co-founder of The Economy for the Common Good. We will also take a closer look at the so-called German Action Plan for Business and Human Rights of 2016, and will ask Heike Drillisch from the Network for Corporate Responsibility why she, and with her, the German Federation of Trade Unions, the Human Rights Forum, and many other civil society organizations consider the halftime result of this action plan to be meager. And we will be talking about the Fridays for Future movement, which, starting in Sweden, is taking students in more and more European countries out onto the streets against climate change and the hesitant political decision makers.
First, on the subject of resistance and civil disobedience, which becomes more visible and more audible in so many places. In the Hambach forest between Cologne and Aachen in Germany, people show their protest against logging by living in tree houses. In France, the Yellow Vests occupy roads and bridges. And at this year's climate summit in Katowice in Poland, it is the 16-year-old Swedish climate activist Greta Thunberg who held a lecture in front of the state representatives and then demonstrates in a tent in the icy Swiss town of Davos at the World Economic Forum in front of the world's powerful.
But what is civil disobedience? What drives people today to deliberately violate laws in order to achieve urgent social goals? Be it for the preservation of a forest, be it for social justice, or be it for climate protection. Is it simply the wish to be right politically? Or is it not rather the basic conviction of I no longer want to have to endure that society is unjust? Isn't the driving force rather a deep sense of being connected with the world and all its living beings, beyond all ideology. A tree inhabitant in the Hambach forest lives this visible connection between spirituality and politics and described it with a charming sentence, "I am the thinking part of the forest." We now hear an interview with Christian Felber, in which he explains his motivation for his political work. Seit vielen Jahren engagierst du dich im Widerstand gegen unsere profitorientierte Wirtschaft.
For many years you have been engaged in resisting our profit-oriented economy. 8 years ago, you co-founded the Economy for the Common Good, you give lectures on it, and sometimes you present alternatives by dancing. And you have written a book about the inner voice that drives you. So, your political commitment is not a detached end in itself. What is your personal motivation for your political work?
Es sind mehrere Motivationen, aber vielleicht lässt sich's am besten zusammenfassen auf.
There are several motivations, but perhaps it can best be summed up in the twin pair freedom and responsibility. On the one hand, I am a free spirit, and it is my deepest concern to think freely and to think of alternatives to the way we currently live together and to drag down the human being on both the individual and the collective level, to realize ourselves in this way, both individually and collectively. This is a deepest striving for freedom and according to my understanding. I am a very freedom-loving person on the one hand, and at the same time, I am very connected because we are not only individuals, but also social beings and very dependent on other people. If we do not have successful relationships, then we will die and we will even give up eating if we have no relationships. This is scientifically proven. This means that Bertolt Brecht is a little bit wrong here, and Margaret Thatcher, of course, is much more wrong saying that there are only individuals, but there is no such thing as a society. This is the greatest possible mutilation of us humans, because it only emphasizes the individual dimension, but at the same time denies the social dimension and the dimension of connectedness. And I have always felt this deeply since my early childhood. That is why it was important to me that the planet is doing well and that other people are doing well. That is why I am naturally, voluntarily and intrinsically motivated for the common good. Others call this the taking over of social responsibility or responsibility for society. For me, this is the second twin of the pursuit of freedom.
Exactly this second twin was described by a tree inhabitant in the Hambach forest with the following sentence: "I am the thinking part of the forest." I suspect you can associate something with this sentence, right? Do you feel like a dancing part of something?
That would be this second dimension, the big picture. I feel like I'm part of the big picture. And in my own personal case, I was allowed to experience being part of the big picture. And then you can feel with the big picture. You can also think with the big picture. In the sense that you can share information that you might not be able to study at any university. That happens to me again and again. So I would also understand that if an environmentalist fuses with a tree or an ecosystem, he can also share very profound and subtle information with this larger entity, because he becomes an identity with this larger entity. That's how I understand it right now. But of course, I would like to listen to him to understand exactly what he wanted to say with this sentence.
Unfortunately, we can't do that now, but we found this sentence important as a key sentence for our radio show on civil disobedience, which in these days is more and more visibly connected with spirituality. We experienced less spirituality at the last World Economic Forum in Davos. What impression do you have when you look back at the Davos Forum in view of the predominant theme there, namely the concern expressed again and again about the end of global growth?
Setback, not only because of the concern of monetary economic growth instead of internal growth or growth of global solidarity or ecological sustainability and climate stability. That would be wonderful if that would grow. But they are not seriously concerned about this growth. They are concerned about economic growth, measured in monetary terms. But not only because of this, but also because the motto of Davos itself points in a completely traditional, industry-friendly and unconnected direction, namely globalization 4.0, the fourth industrial revolution, with digitization in the meaning of how to do business with it. This is a relapse into old habits. They also stand in stark contrast to the prominently launched risk report of the World Economic Forum. Risks are at the top of the list: loss of biodiversity, loss of the stability of the world's ecosystems. The motto simply doesn't fit in at all. That is a stark contradiction that says everything. Even Greta Thunberg was only allowed to speak after the conference was over, although she would have addressed exactly these topics, the global ecological topics. Yes, that says everything. And that brings me to the conclusion. Unfortunately, we have to observe a step backwards here.
Because this is unfortunately the case, there have been alternatives to the Davos World Economic Forum for many years now. Since 2001, there has been the so-called World Social Forum, an annual meeting of globalization critics. It was first held in Porto Alegre, Brazil. Then there was the so-called NESI, the New Economy and Social Innovation Forum. And now, from 7 to 9 April this year, the so-called Best Economy Forum will take place for the first time in Bolzano, Italy, also in the mountains. What will it be about? Is this a counter-event to the World Economic Forum in Davos? What is it?
Yes, these are both alternative events. With respect to the keyword alternatives, the World Economic Forum must ultimately be judged by what impact it has and whether it finally leads to the establishment of a human rights court or the conclusion of the UN binding treaty, which would call international corporations to account, or that the Paris Climate Agreement becomes enforceable, or that they, the heads of state and government, talk about carbon taxes and carbon custom duties to countries that do not have carbon taxes, or an international financial register where all financial assets are registered so that they can be taxed globally. They don't even talk about it, and that's why even the politicians who dance up there, they are summoned to go there. And if they then don't talk about these crucial human concerns at all, then logically, they can't implement them in their democratic forums later. The World Social Forum was once thought as a forum where these actual topics, that is, concerns about humanity, that is, at least the concerns of the majority of people, are prominently addressed. Unfortunately, the politicians did not go there. At best, those of the host countries such as Brazil, for example. But that was it. In Davos, the power relations, in the sense that politicians come unilaterally to the powerful, but not to those who actually represent the majority of the people, are not addressed at all. That's why we need these alternative forums. The World Social Forum is, on the one hand, a mass event from which individual campaigns can then emerge, such as the Global Tax Justice Network. And NASI is somewhat narrower or more focused on alternative economic approaches, such as the economy for the common good, the solidarity economy, the degrowth network, or the commons. Diego Isabel from Spain has tried to bring them together. This is smaller than the World Social Forum, but more focused on alternative economic approaches. And even smaller, we will see how this develops, is now the Best Economy Forum, which is organized by alternative business associations, by companies that have initiated an alternative business practice, such as organic hotels or organic agriculture, or companies that apply the common good balance sheet. These are the three main organizers. And now we make a first small test balloon fly, expecting a few hundred participants. Then look at it, how it will go, whether it will be continued, and whether it will be merged with larger forums. Now it's just a test balloon, and then we'll see.
I'm curious about it. We will probably also report from there. The practical approaches of companies that are already moving in a certain direction, which corresponds to the need of the majority of the people, are exciting. Christian, we have come to the end of the interview. Thank you very much for your assessments.
Ob es dann weitergeführt wird, ob es mit größeren Foren verschmolzen wird, es ist einmal ein Testballon und dann sehen wir weiter.
Maybe Greta Thunberg will come to our next Best Economy Forum in Bolzano. In Davos, for now, on the occasion of the World Economic Forum 2019, she made the following impressive statement.
I am here to say our house is on fire. According to the IPCC, we are less than 12 years away from not being able to undo our mistakes. At places like Davos, people like to tell success stories, but their financial success has come with an unthinkable price tag. We are facing a disaster of unspoken sufferings for enormous amounts of people. And now is not the time for speaking politely. Now is the time to speak clearly. Here in Davos, just like everywhere else, everyone is talking about money. It seems that money and growth are our only main concerns. People are simply not aware that there is such a thing as a carbon budget and just how incredibly small that remaining carbon budget is. And that needs to change today. No other current challenge can match the importance of establishing a wide public awareness and understanding of our rapidly disappearing carbon budget that should and must become our new global currency and the very heart of future and present economics. We must change almost everything in our current societies. Adults keep saying, we owe it to the young people to give them hope. But I don't want your hope. I don't want you to be hopeful. I want you to panic. I want you to feel the fear I feel every day.
We need to start right now.
One topic that is specifically in the focus of the economy for the common good is the respect of human rights by companies. Progressive companies are already documenting in a so-called common good balance sheet how they protect the environment, how they treat men and women equally in the workplace, and how they comply with human rights in their supply chain. But what to do with companies that do not respect human rights?
In 2016, the German government adopted the so-called National Action Plan for Business and Human Rights. After all, it obliges half of German companies with more than 500 employees, that is around 6,500 companies in Germany, to integrate human rights diligence into their processes by 2020, so already by next year. The companies and their suppliers should, among other things, ensure that, for instance, escape routes exist in their production facilities, that women are not discriminated against, that no children are employed, that adequate wages are paid, and that 60 hours of work per week are not exceeded.
In Indian quarries, however, children still knock our gravestones today and have an average life expectancy of only 35 years. In 2012, 258 seamstresses died in a burning Pakistani textile factory where they produced clothing for the German textile discounter Kick. In such cases, the German Action Plan for Business and Human Rights provides for a complaints mechanism for the victims concerned, but not for legal proceedings or fines.
The public interest was high when in 2016 five survivors of the factory fire filed a lawsuit against Kick at the Dortmund District Court for lack of fire protection, and each demanded €30,000 compensation for pain and suffering. Ultimately, however, it was about much more than just compensation for pain and suffering. The fundamental question that affects the division of labor in times of globalization was put to the test, namely, how far-reaching is the responsibility of companies for working conditions and standards of their suppliers in countries of the global south? Because they often deliberately outsource their production to low-wage countries like Pakistan, precisely because the standards there are low. This is exactly how companies make high profits. They like to look away and reject responsibility when human rights are violated in their supply chains. At the same time, however, they also sue for lost profits from states before private arbitration tribunals if the states introduce stricter environmental regulations or a minimum wage, for example.
I interviewed Heike Drillisch from Berlin on this topic.
Guten Abend nach Berlin, Heike Drillisch, und herzlich willkommen in der Sendung.
Ja, hallo, guten Abend nach München.
For 6 years, Heike has been coordinating CORA, a network for corporate responsibility, an association of 60 organizations from the fields of development, human rights, environment, consumer protection, and trade unions. Its aim is to make corporate responsibility a legal binding duty, in contrast to the still prevailing voluntary concept of corporate social responsibility, which companies often only use as greenwashing. Heike, the plaintiffs have unfortunately failed in their claim for damages against Kick before the Dortmund Regional Court. Why? And why was this procedure still so important?
It was important because it was the first time that a court in Germany had allowed such a lawsuit against a German company by victims of human rights violations that occurred abroad. That was already significant in itself. But unfortunately, the case has now been dropped due to statute of limitations. Before the legal proceedings were opened, Kick had assured that it did not want to use the statute of limitations argument, but was interested in getting an answer by a German court on the question of what responsibilities and what precise due diligence obligations a German company must comply with. But contrary to its announcement, KIK has now appealed to the statute of limitations, and the regional court then also saw it that way. There were legal expert opinions presented to the court saying that the limitation period was interrupted and that the lawsuit could have been admitted and pursued. Unfortunately, the Dortmund regional court did not see it that way. This means that the central question of companies' responsibility and liability has not been clarified. Nevertheless, the proceedings had a great effect, because at the same time there were talks between KIK and the victims, moderated by the International Labour Organization, in which KIK agreed to pay compensation of $5 million. This willingness was certainly reinforced by the fact that legal action had been announced. But, as I said, the fact that a company first declares that it waives the statute of limitation and then invokes it is very disappointing, and once again show the great obstacles for victims of human rights violations that occurred abroad to be able to go to court here in Germany. Ultimately, there were only 4 victims who filed a complaint, although over 250 people were affected. Because it's so difficult and no collective lawsuits are possible here, there is definitely a great need for improvement.
There is a need of improvement, definitely. But perhaps there is already a small glimmer of hope, and that could lie in the German Action Plan for Business and Human Rights mentioned before. Heike, you have accompanied the 2-year journey towards this action plan, and even today you are still closely observing whether the government is actually keeping its promise from the current coalition agreement. This coalition agreement states, and I quote, "We are committed to the consistent implementation of the National Action Plan, including public procurement. If the effective and comprehensive review of this plan leads to the conclusion that the voluntary commitment of companies is not sufficient, we will take national legal action and advocate an EU-wide regulation." End of quote. The government is currently examining the extent to which companies based in Germany comply with their human rights due diligence obligations and has, for this purpose, invited 6,500 companies to participate in the review. But how can the government check such internal company procedures at all? What does this review procedure look like? And what do you think of it?
4 companies have been commissioned to carry out this review, interesting enough by Ernst & Young as management consultants. Random samples will be taken from the 6,500 companies. In a first phase, a questionnaire is sent to a small group of these 6,500 companies in order to optimize the review questionnaire. In a second and third phase, in autumn 2019 and next year 2020, approximately 375 to 400 companies should have returned the completed questionnaires. And on this basis, a statistically valid statement will then be made. The problem is that the review remains completely anonymous, so we cannot find out which companies are being reviewed. For civil society or trade unions, there is no way to include critical information in this review. In addition, the answers to the questions are voluntary. It can be assumed that companies that already have something to offer in terms of due diligence tend to respond. This will very much distort the result. In addition, most of the questions are multiple choice questions that show what the good and desirable answers are. This leads to a further distortion. Only in cases of obvious contradictions in the answers of the companies, a further plausibility check will be done. This will probably happen in very few cases. Our central criticism is that procedures are checked that the companies themselves have designed. But our job is to ensure that human rights due diligence procedures are effective on the ground. That will not be examined in this review. It is also completely unclear what companies actually have to present. In this respect, we are very concerned and fear that this review will not really tell us whether 50% of companies have in fact already established human rights due diligence procedures and whether these are effective or not. In addition, it is fundamentally questionable what we should do with all those companies that are doing nothing to improve their human rights record. They would also have to be persuaded to introduce procedures to comply with the human rights duty of care.
So do you fear that Germany will not enact a law on corporate due diligence in 2020, just as France has done? The French Parliament passed a corporate due diligence law in 2018, and Germany lags behind, right?
Yes, Germany lags behind. France is a pioneer and was the first country to enact a due diligence act. We are calling on the German government to prepare such a law so that it can be enacted by 2020. The business associations and the Ministry of Economic Affairs will certainly act very strongly against this and will continue to rely on only voluntary action by the companies. But we think there should simply be no more cases like the fire at Ali Enterprises in Pakistan with its disastrous consequences.
Let me come back to the National Action Plan. It also contains a commitment on the part of the government. It expressly states, and I quote, "The federal government, the regional and local authorities have a special responsibility in public procurement. They must comply with their state duty of protection and ensure that public funds do not have any negative impact on human rights." End of quotation. How does the government comply with its own obligation to respect human rights?
Unfortunately, not very satisfactorily. Parallel to the preparation of the National Action Plan, the government had to transpose an EU directive on public procurement into national law. In doing so, the government failed to clearly state that human rights must also be observed in public procurement. One of our member organizations, the Christian Initiative Romero, had found out that German military uniforms are produced in Tunisia by a German company called Leo Köhler and procured for the German army via one of the central procurement agencies of the government. The Christian Initiative Romero and its partner organizations in Tunisia have spoken to the workers and found out that they are being put under pressure, being used as spies, and that the union has been dissolved and that wages are far from sufficient to cover basic needs.
And all this in the public interest, in the interest of the German army?
Yes, and produced by a German company. We expect the German government to urgently change course and, as a pioneer in its own public procurement, to create transparency about what is produced where and whether human rights are respected.
I would like to talk briefly with you about the so-called UN Binding Treaty. Do you see a connection between the National Action Plan and the current negotiation process in Geneva, which aims to oblige companies to observe human rights?
Actually, the government, if it says that it has an interest in combining business and human rights, should be committed at the UN to ensure that there is an international treaty binding companies to respect human rights in other countries as well. Unfortunately, the government is very, very hesitant to do so and has hardly participated in the negotiation process in Geneva so far.
On the contrary, it obviously blocks the process.
Yes, it does so. And the European Union, too, has been slowing down the process so far and repeatedly finds reason not to participate. The European Union and the German government have not yet commented seriously on the UN draft agreement. We expect the government to finally comment on the draft together with the EU.
And we can increase this pressure on the government, and by the way, on all other European governments as well. Since 22nd January, on the occasion of the start of the Davos World Economic Forum, an international campaign was launched. In the first 3 days, 200,000 people have already signed. Dear listeners, under www.stopisds.org, you can also sign. Dear Heike, thank you very much for the interview and many greetings to Berlin.
Ich wünsche Ihnen noch einen ganz schönen Abend und schöne Grüße nach Berlin.
Dankeschön.
Tschüss.
Why go to school when there is no future? This question was written on a banner made by students who have been striking for some weeks under the motto Fridays for Future. With their demonstrations, they point out the urgency to fight the climate catastrophe and to keep planet Earth habitable. After all, they are the ones who will suffer the fatal consequences of climate change. We have invited Jan Runge from the Munich group of Fridays for Future to inform us about the current status of the movement and how it will continue.
Ihr hattet ja auch gefordert mit dem Wirtschaftsministerium.
You are calling for a discussion with the Ministry of Economic Affairs because the Ministry of Education will not be able to stop the climate catastrophe through educational means. Important for you are the Ministry of Environment and the Ministry of Economic Affairs. Do you have contacts to these two ministries? Did they make any statements already?
The ministries have not yet commented our activities at all, and there was no contact yet. But to be honest, that's not so surprising. The Ministry of Economic Affairs would probably rather take the side of corporations or business that exploit the environment.
Still, you want to talk to these two ministries, but also to the Ministry of Environment. How would you describe such talks? You then go into the meetings with prepared files and statistics and negotiate and play poker? What would your demands be? How would you proceed?
In any case, we would look for the discussion and we would perhaps rather take the innocent perspective of the students. We would argue that it is up to us now to make sure that we can live in a world where we can really still live. You adults don't have to deal with the consequences of your politics of waiting. That would probably be our way of arguing. We would certainly argue with statistics and facts, but of course, we are not professional politicians. We are still students.
You want to be taken serious at eye level. That's probably your concern, isn't it?
Yeah, that's definitely a big concern, because we young people in politics are often not taken seriously. We are smiled at. But we definitely want a discourse at eye level, which I think we will get now with the pressure.
A representative of yours from Berlin said that the compromise recently reached by the German Coal Commission is a betrayal of young people. Do you agree that there are no real measures to react quickly, but postpone everything until 2038?
Yes, because that's the opposite of fast. With the coal compromise, Germany is the country that will get out of coal in the EU at the latest. We call for an immediate phase out of coal, because as I said, it is up to our generation to then bear all the consequences of this excessive coal consumption, this pollution from coal.
Why did Fridays for Future come about right now? What motivates you right now to take to the streets in order to preserve people's livelihoods? After all, the consequences of the climate catastrophe have been known for many years and are also being discussed in public.
I think the current impulse comes from Greta Thunberg, who has stood up in front of the Swedish parliament and is protesting every Friday for a better climate policy. I think the strength was already there. People were just waiting to take to the streets now, to be able to do something now. Now we have the opportunity. That's why the masses of school children who were just waiting for something to happen are now mobilizing. For most people, it is clear that there will be a climate catastrophe, which will probably take place in our generation or in the generation after.
You demonstrate during class time and deliberately break the rules. What motivates you to even accept personal consequences for a general concern like climate protection?
On the one hand, there is this rather selfish point of our generation, which has to bear the consequences of the climate catastrophe. On the other hand, I think it also plays a big role that we turn against the current system with our demands. These concrete, almost radical demands for an immediate exit from coal. In doing so, we are also changing the system, which is helping us in this matter, because there is media attention and more pressure. We also notice this because we are invited by the Ministry of Culture or, for example, can speak on such radio programs as this one.
I'd like to dig deeper. There are many other pupils, probably in your class as well, who do not take to the street, who might be afraid of a reprimand or from being even expelled from school and say, no, I'd rather stay quiet, learn for my high school degrees, write good exams, because my grades are more important to me now. And there you say, no, I'm going to skip math, religion, or whatever it is that's on Friday in class. I just have to learn it later. Those are already additional burdens that you take on yourself. It may be that you may have to suffer from the climate catastrophe. That is why you say that your commitment to climate protection is selfish. At the same time, you want to save the climate for everyone, so that all people live well, right?
Yes, of course. I also want to do something for everyone, also for the generation after and again for the next. Actually, for all subsequent generations, which at the moment are given little consideration. And as far as the people from my class are concerned, why it is not everyone who goes there, I think they don't have the awareness that they can change something. It's not just about general consumption criticism or about us separating the garbage or just buying organic. The point is that each and every one of us can make a difference in the system with such demonstrations and with concrete political demands.
So you have the impression that they are not yet aware of their own power as students to take political influence?
Exactly. This behavior is also the result of decades of depolitizing the schools. It is very much in the interest of conservative parties, for example, if people are not interested in politics, because then there is no pressure for parties to act. Some people still live up to the motto, we live our lives and adapt, and whatever happens doesn't really matter to us. Hopefully, this will change a bit over time.
Thank you very much, Jan. It was very nice that you came to the studio. We wish you continued success and much strength.
Dankeschön.
This brings us to the end of our program.
Further information on the economy for the common good can be found on our website ecogood.org.
From the studio,
Reinhard Schwarz
and Andrea Behm say thank you for your interest and
goodbye.